Dear students, I am Dhanraj, DL in Commerce, TTWRDC Men, Sangareddy. So as part of online classes, today I am going to teach financial accounting subject. In that financial accounting subject, we are going to discuss about subsidiary books chapter. So we all know that every business organization has to maintain accounts. So in that accounts, the business organization has to start with recording all the transactions, all the business related monetary transactions will be recorded according to chronological order. So from starting to recording journal entries till the end of final accounts preparation, so this all will come under accounting only. So today we will discuss about the subsidiary books. So we all know that how to generalize the transactions. So the journal entries will be recorded in primary book. So even subsidiary books also we can call it as primary book, because the first entries will be taken place in primary book only. So for the convenience of the management and the accounting, the same categorized journal entries will be recorded in a separate books. All those books are called as subsidiary books. Okay, today we will discuss in detail about the subsidiary books. What are the subsidiary books and the advantages, disadvantages? At the same time, the subsidiary books types also we are going to discuss. So coming to introduction, the subsidiary books are the book of original entry, and it is also called primary records because the first entry of transaction is made in subsidiary books. As I have told you, the first entries, all the transactions, the business related monetary transactions will be recorded in primary books. All those books are called as subsidiary books. On the basis of subsidiary books only, the postings are made into concerned account afterwards. That is nothing but secondary books. After the recording the journal entries or the transactions in primary books, that same entries will be recorded in the secondary books. The books are called as ledgers. So here, every business organization will be recorded all the transactions. Then why we need subsidiary books? So there are some advantages for subsidiary book. That is the reason why the big business concerns or business organizations will maintain subsidiary books. So the first advantage, that is posting of each entry becomes very easy. So in journal entries, we cannot categorize every entry, but in subsidiary books, we have to categorize the transactions. The same correlated transactions will be recorded in a separate book. So that will become very easy for the accountant. Then you can see the second one. As one type of transaction that are recorded in one books, so it becomes convenient to locate any desired transaction. So when you categorize the transactions, are the same correlated or related transactions will be recorded in a separate book, then the location or access will become very easy. Then third one is important descriptions about the transaction is also made in the related books. So a lot of information related to the transaction is easily accessible. So the same related transactions will be recorded in a separate book. Because of this reason only, it is very easy to get the required information for the management. So not only the advantage, there are some little bit disadvantage also there for maintaining subsidiary books. The first one is they may be expensive. In case of a small business concern or business organization, it is best to keep journal only. So for example, there are n number of business organizations are running in the economy. For smaller ones, categorizing these transactions and maintaining separate books for separate purposes, it will become something cost for them. Then next you can see that it requires some basic knowledge of accountancy. So for journal entries recording, the basic person or the basic minimum knowledge is required. But to maintain separate set of books as subsidiary books, the person has to categorize, the person has to identify which transaction will come in which book. All this kind extra knowledge will be required. So coming to the types of subsidiary books, there are many types of subsidiary books. but the popular ones that we are going to discuss now. The first one is purchase book, second one is sales book, third one is cash book, fourth one is purchase return book, fifth one is sales return book, sixth one is bills receivable book and bills payable book. Okay, so these are the main and popular types of subsidiary books. So by taking one by one, we will discuss in detail. So you can see the first one, purchase book. So in every organization will purchase something that they require. For example, a manufacturing concern, they may require raw material. For the trading business people, they may require goods. So whenever the goods any organization purchases on the basis of credit, all those transactions will be recorded in purchase book only. So you can see the points here. This book is used for recording goods purchased on the basis of credit. So business concern may purchase goods on the basis of cash, at the same time on the basis of credit also. So in this purchase book, only the credit transactions, only the credit purchases that we have to record. Then you can see the next one, also known as invoice book, bought book or purchased book or purchased journal. This book is called in many names. So as you see that invoice book, bought book or purchase journal. So the next point is, it is not necessary to record the transaction in journal book where they are entered in the purchase book. So we have already discussed that instead of maintaining journal, instead of writing the transactions in journal, we are maintaining subsidiary books. So the transactions which are being recorded in purchased book, those transactions will not be recorded in journal book. So it is nothing but the alternative for that. So you can see the format here, the purchase book, how the purchase book will look like. You can see here. So in the first column, the date, second column, the particulars, third column, invoice number, the fourth column is ledger folio, and the last one is amount. So in date column, so all those transactions, even in journal book also, we will write the transactions in a chronological order. So at the same time, in whenever we maintain the subsidiary books, in purchase book also, we have to write the transactions according to the chronological order only. That is nothing but date by date wise. So on first date, it may take some transactions, we have to write that first. On second date, we have to write that second. So like that, we have to maintain our books in a chronological manner. So in the second column, particulars, so what are the goods that we have purchased, and sometimes the quantity also we can mention here, and whatever the details that we can put in a short form, those transactions and those names will be recorded in the particular column. So invoice number, as usual, that we have to write on the third column. Then next you can see that ledger folio. LF means ledger folio. In that ledger folio, we have to write the page number of ledger account related to this particular transaction. So here we are writing transactions in primary book. At the same time, we have to post the same journal entry or same entry in the secondary book, that is called ledger. So where that we are going to post. So that page number we have to write here. So it will become easy to access the same information in primary book as well as secondary book. For that purpose only, we are maintaining this fourth column, that is called ledger folio number. Okay, the last one is amount column. So whatever the amount that we have purchased, the number or the financial number will be posted on the last column, that is amount column. So this is all about purchased book. So don't be confused, only the good, when we purchase the goods, that too on the basis of credit, only those transactions will be recorded in this book. That book is called purchase book. So second one, sales book. Not only purchases, business concern or business organization will make sales also. For example, you can take a manufacturing business organization, they can sell the goods which they have manufactured. Or some trading business organizations, they may purchase goods and they may sell goods for some profit. So they can also write those transactions in sales book. But there are two conditions. The sale must take place on the basis of credit only. the cashiers will not be recorded in sales book. And the second one, the material or the main products, they must be goods only, not even assets or any other items will be recorded in this book. Okay, the record in sales book is made from the outward invoice book, which contain the exact copy of the each invoice sent out to the customers. So now we can see the format of sales book also. As usual, it is also same, looks like as purchase book. The same columns will appear here that we have already discussed. In date column, we have to post date. In particular column, we have to write some particulars regarding the sales made, and the outward invoice number also we have to put. At the same time, ledger folio number, that the same transactions will be recorded in secondary book, that book page number will be written here, and at the same time in amount column we have to post the amount. So this is all about sales book. Then coming to third one, purchase written book. So business organizations may purchase goods or raw material, whatever. So whatever they purchased, sometimes they don't like them. Sometimes the quality may be different. Sometimes the price may be different. Sometimes they may get some damaged goods also. So reason, whatever may be the reason, according to agreement, they can return those goods, whatever they have purchased, if they don't like. So that should be according to agreement only. So all those purchased written goods will be recorded in a separate book. That book is called as purchase written book. So okay, we have purchased, when we purchase the goods, we are going to record and purchase book. At the same time, when we are returning the same purchased goods, we are writing in a separate book. That book is called as purchase written book. So also known as written outward books, because the goods are going out. So while returning goods, buyer prepares even debit note also. So here you can see the format of purchase written book. So same format as usual that we have already discussed: date particulars, ledger folio, debit notes and amount. So all those transactions, definitely as we have discussed, we have to write chronological order only. So one more book, that is sales written book. So not only we return the goods, the buyers who have bought the goods from us, they may also return the same goods to us if they don't like. So sometimes the purchased person or the consumer, they may not like our goods because of some quality difference or price difference or damaged goods that we have delivered to him. So because of one or other reason, thus purchased person, if he returns the goods to the organization, then the organization or business people will have to write those transactions in sales written book. It is nothing but the sales which you have made, the goods are coming back. So all those transactions will be recorded in a separate book. That book is called as sales written book. It is also known as written inward book, because the goods are coming inward. Here, while keeping records in sales written books, sellers prepares a credit note. Earlier it was debit note, now the credit note. Coming to format of sales written book. So whenever the sales return takes place, we have to record all those transactions in a separate book, that is sales written book. In that book, the first one, date, particulars, ledger folio, credit note and amount. So the format is look like the same as we have discussed earlier. So in date column, we have to post the date. In particulars column, we have to write all those particulars regarding sales written. In ledger folio, we have to post the number. In credit note also, we have to write. In amount also, the final financial number that we have to post. So coming to one more book, that is cash book. So it is one of the important book It is one of the important subsidiary book. This book is having some unique features as compared with other books. So here you can see that to record cash transactions, separate book is kept, which is called cash book. So in small or in a big, any organization, the cash transactions will take place. Okay, all those transactions will be recorded in a separate book. That book is called as cash book. The function of cash book is to keep records of all cash transactions. Okay, cash transactions or cash book takes the place of cash account. That is, it is not necessary to open separate cash account in the ledger after keeping record in the cash book. So here you can see that a unique feature, that cash book will act as a cash account also. Here the separate cash account book we cannot write, because the same primary cash book will work as a secondary book as cash account. So this is one of the unique feature of cash book. So in this cash book there are four types of cash books that we can observe. The first one is simple cash book, the second one is double column cash book, the third one is triple column cash book, the fourth one is petty cash book. So we will discuss one by one in detail. The first one, simple cash book, prepared like cash account in ledger. All the cash received are entered in amounts column on debit side, and all cash paid appear on credit side in amount column. So here all the amount that we have received, that we must write on the debit side, and all the amount which is going out of the business, that we must write on the credit side. So whenever you purchase, whenever you sell, so the cash comes and cash goes out. So according to the real account only, the coming asset must be debited and the going asset must be credited. So every time, whatever the digital entry or whatever the transaction that you are recording, you must keep in mind the rules of accounting. Okay, on that basis only we have to write all the journal entries. So cash book is closed and balanced at the end of the month. So whatever the balance will be left in the book, that will become the opening balance for next month. So here in single column cash book we can find only cash column. So here you can look the format of cash book here. So it is a little bit different from as earlier what we have discussed, or like other subsidiary books. So here the account will be, it look like an account. So here the two parts you can see, the left part side and the right part side. The left part side is called as debit side, and the right part side you can call it as credit side. So here on the left side, date, particulars, ledger folio and amount. At the same time on the right side also you can see the same columns, that is dates, particulars, ledger folio and amount. So whatever, whenever the cash coming you have to write on the debit side, whenever the cash going you have to write on the credit side, that too according to the journal entries. So to post all these transactions, we must be perfect in generalizing the transactions. So that is must and should. When you cannot generalize any transaction, that you cannot write in subsidiary books. So for example, you can take that, I will give one example. You purchased a building for 10 lakhs. So what is the journal entry for this? Purchased building means the building coming and the cash going. So here the building account data to cash account. So here the cash going, that is nothing but going outside. So what we have discussed, the whenever the cash is going outside, you must write on the credit side. So whenever the cash is coming inside, you must write on the debit side. So here by building, you can write as by building, and in amount column, you can write 10 lakh rupees. So on the left side, I will give one more example. Suppose you have sold land for 15 lakhs. Whenever you are selling something, that you will get to cash. So the coming cash must be debited. So here you can write as 2 land In amount column, you have to write 15 lakhs rupees. So whatever the cash coming inside, we must write on the debit side, and whatever the cash going outside, we must write on the credit side. So here you can see the second type of cash book, that is called as double column cash book. So here a cash book with the discount column is called a double column cash book. So not only the only cash here, when the cash book is added with one more column, that is called discount column, then that book is known as double column cash book. Two accounts, cash and discounts, are combined in this book. Discount allowed to the customers represents loss. So here you can see the model of double column cash book or format. So here the same, it look like an account. On the debit side, the first column as usual, that is date, second column particulars, ledger, folio. Then fourth column, you can observe the new one has entered in this cash book, that is discount column. Earlier it was not there in single column cash book, but it is appearing now in double entry. So the amount column we have to post on the amount. At the same time, the discount column will appear on the right side, that is nothing but credit side also. So here in double column, there are two columns that which we have to record, is discount column and cash column. So here sometimes the for cash transactions, business organizations may offer discount. At the same time, the business people may purchase goods on the basis of discount. So when we give discount to others, that is nothing but loss for us. So all the losses must be debited according to nominal account, so that we should record on the debit side. So whenever you purchase goods from others, you may receive some kind of discounts. That discounts received is nothing but that we have gained something. So all the gains must be created according to nominal account. So when you receive the discount, you must write on the credit side. When you offer the discount, you must write on the debit side. So next type of cash book, that is triple column cash book. So here the not only we find a cash column, discount column, in addition to that we will find that bank column also. So here we can find the three columns, cash, discount and bank. So this account or this book or this primary subsidiary book will be called as triple column cash book. So this also will be acted as secondary book or secondary cash account. So the business organizations may not do business only in cash. Sometimes they may receive checks instead of cash. Sometimes they offer checks instead of cash. So here, whenever you are taking benefit through bank or through check, you must write in bank column only that you are not taking the cash. Because of that reason, we are adding one more column, that is bank. Sometimes you may offer checks to the other people also, then you will lose money from bank. So these kind of transactions, the banking related payments or receivables, that we must write on the bank column only. So here you can see the triple column cash book format. So here also it looks like the same as earlier that we have discussed, like double column, but one more column as added, that is bank column, that too on the both side. So debit side also the bank column added, and the credit side also the bank column added. So here you can look that date, particulars, ledger, folio, discount, amount. Amount is nothing but cash, and bank. So right side also date, particulars, ledger, folio, discount, amount and cash. So here whenever you are receiving amount in the form of check or through bank, you have to write on the debit side, that is in bank column only. Whenever you offer checks to other people or you can pay amount through bank, that you must write on the credit side of bank. So it is like same, when you receive the money you will write on the debit side, when you receive the check you will write on the debit side only, but in bank column. But when you pay amount you must write on the credit side in cash column, but when you pay through check then you have to write on the right side, that is credit side, in bank column only. So next one, that is petty cash book. I will give some explanation before we discuss about petty cash book. There are big organizations or big business organizations, the number of cash transactions will take place in day to day. So sometimes they may purchase one more building for 10 crores, they may purchase land for 20 crores, like that. In that same business or in the same organization, some small cash transactions also will take place. Suppose for example 200 rupees for stationery purpose and 300 rupees for printing purpose. All those very small cash transactions will take place. At the same time, very big amount of cash transactions also will take place. But for maintaining purposes, combining or recording all those small and big transactions in the same cash book, it will be very inconvenient to the management to look or to analyze the cash book. Because of that reason, for small transactions we have to maintain a separate book. That book is called as petty cash book. So here the big organizations will maintain this kind of petty cash book separately to record all those small amount transactions. So what is the small amount? It may be different from organization to organizations. Some people may feel below 1000 it will be small amount. Some big organizations, that they may feel below 1 lakh also it will be a small transaction. So according to the size of the organization or the management, they will decide what kind of transactions or how small the transactions will be recorded in petty cash book. So here you can look, use it to record small amount of expenses like stationery, cleaning charges and postage. So you can see the format of petty cash book: date particulars amount, date particulars amount. So here we cannot write this petty cash book in further, because of that reason there are less columns that we can found in this primary book. Only in particulars columns we have to write for the purpose which we have spent amount. In the amount column we have to post amount. Then next, bills receivable book. So far we have discussed purchase book, sales book, purchase return book, sales return book and cash book. In that cash book also we have already discussed the types of cash books, that are nothing but single column cash book, double column cash book, triple column cash book and finally even petty cash book also, that we have discussed. So now we will discuss about bills receivable book. So before discussing bills receivable book, I will give some explanation about bills. So business organizations, they may sell goods on the basis of credit, that we know that. So whenever they sell the goods on the basis of credit, the purchased person will not pay the amount immediately. Then what is the solution? So if he is not ready to pay immediately, then he may accept that he will pay the same amount after some time. So here the financial instrument will enter into the transaction. That instrument is called as bill. So the seller will write a bill on the purchased person. So that is debtor. So in that bill, he may write, the seller will write so and so amount, so and so goods, so and so person, after so and so date, you have to give money. And from that person or the debtor, the purchased person has to sign on that bill. So the bill writer will, the bill writer will take the bill by making, by taking the sign of purchased person. So here this will be called as bills receivables. So here all those transactions will be recorded separately, that is called in bills receivable book. So here you can see that bills receivable book is used to record the bills receivable from debtors. When a bill is received, details of it are recorded in the bills receivable book. In the ledger, the account of the person from whom each bill is received is credited with the amount of that bill, and the periodical total of the book is posted to the debit of bills receivable account. So you can see the format of bills receivable book: date, from whom received, the term, due date, ledger folio, and the amount. So here in particular column, the person name must be mentioned from whom we are going to receive the amount. So due date also we have to write, after how many days or a particular date, after how many months, that we have to write here. In the amount column, at the same time, the amount we have to post. So this is all about bills receivable book. So next one, bills payable book. So sometimes the business organizations also will purchase goods on the basis of credit. When they purchase goods on the basis of credit, they may not pay the amount immediately, so that they can accept a bill from the seller. So here the seller will write bill on us, that we will sign on that bill and we will submit the same bill to the seller. So seller here, he will become the creditor, then we will become the debtor. So here it is noted as bills payable book. So whatever the bills that we have accepted, that we have to pay in the future, all those transactions will be recorded in a separate book. That book is called as bills payable book. So you can see here, bills payable book is used to record bills accepted by us. That is nothing but we are accepting to pay the amount later. When a bill drawn by our creditor is accepted, particulars of the same are recorded in this book. In the ledger, the account of each person whose bill has been accepted is debited with the amount of the bill. The monthly total of the bill accepted is credited to the bills payable account ledger. So this is all about bills payable book. So once again, I will rewind all those books from starting. So first one is purchase book, that we have already discussed. In purchase book, we will write only the credit purchases, we will not write the cash transactions. The second book, that is sales book, we will write all those credit sales that we have made. We will write only the credit sales and we will not write the cash sales in sales book. In purchase return book, the whatever the goods that we are getting back from the purchased person, all those transactions will be recorded in a separate book. That book is called as purchase return book. So the next one is sales return book. In sales return books, the purchased goods which we may not like, we return to the suppliers. So all those transactions will be recorded in sales return book. Okay, so that is all about sales return book. Then next, coming to cash book, that also we have discussed. In cash book, there are four types of cash book. One is single column, second one is double column, third one is triple column. So in single column, we will maintain only cash related transactions we will record. Then in double column, we will add one more column, that is discount column. Discount column. And in amount, we have to write only the cash amount. Then next, that is triple column. So we have also discussed about triple column cash book. So here the three columns will be there. One is amount column, one is discount column, and one more is bank column will be added. So the main difference is, in single column we can find only cash, in double column we can find cash plus discount, in triple column we will find cash, discount, and bank column also. So this is the main difference. So as compared with other subsidiary books, the cash book is having one unique feature, that it will act as a secondary book, that is cash account. So here we need not prepare cash account separately. It will act, the cash book will act as a primary book as well as secondary book. So we have discussed even petty cash book also. Only small amounts will be recorded in petty cash book. Even we have discussed about bills receivable book and bills payable book. All the bills receivables that we have written on so and so person, that person has accepted the bill. So that bill will become bills receivable for us. All these transactions will be recorded in a separate book. That book is called as bills receivable book. So at the same time, bills payable book also. So the bills which we have accepted and we have to pay in future to so and so person. So all those transactions are the bills which we have accepted will be recorded in a separate book. That book is called bills payable book. So all these about types of subsidiary books. So don't be confused that why we have to maintain subsidiary books is nothing but just to make our accounts or make our entries very easy to get access and to be separated, and which will be useful in analyzing or to get right information in short period of time. So not only the above said books, there is one more book which is important, that is called journal pauper. So here what kind of transactions will be recorded? So in journal pauper, whatever the transaction that which we cannot record in the earlier said subsidiary books, that transactions will be recorded in journal proper. So be clear, in journal proper we have to record the transactions which cannot be recorded anywhere in other books. Only we can record in journal proper book. So this is all about subsidiary books. So hope you are clear about subsidiary books and what are subsidiary books, advantages, disadvantages of subsidiary books, types of subsidiary books, at the same time why we have to maintain subsidiary books. In accounting, subsidiary books will make very easy for accountant to segregate the journal entries in detail, or to make separate journal entries, the same correlated journal entries will be recorded separately. So that is the main core of subsidiary books. So I hope you understood the topic of subsidiary books. Thank you.